Now, the Duke of Marlborough's redcoats were not fighting sacks of straw, but instead the unbeatable Grand Army of Louis XIV, and Britain's age-old enemy, the French.
Je m'appelle Danny, I am here for your baguettes and escargot and bibliothèque.
Being a Frenchman?
No, we talked about this. It's offensive and not funny. Just stop it.
Moving on, the French soldier was not actually that dissimilar to their British counterparts.
Poor, badly paid, and treated even worse. However, just like the British redcoat, they were often incredibly skilled, very brave. Ultimately, they were a formidable foe.
But the Duke had learned from the French, as had his men, and with new, more aggressive tactics, took the fight to them.
You see, these comings together of bayonets were often over very quickly and very brutally. But at times, company formation broke down entirely, leading to hand-to-hand or indeed musket-to-musket combat, such as in the woods at the bloody Battle of Marlborough. See, the redcoats of 1704 often carried with them a short saber or a hanger.
However, they were not as well trained as their officers, often wielding them more like machetes. At this point, the battlefield looks similar to that of medieval times. The bloodiest battle by far of Marlborough's campaign. And although it ended in a victory, it made many at home question the human cost of war.
See, for many injured soldiers returning home, amputation was often the only course of action available, leading to no possibility of work and a life of poverty.
It was the Duke's mastery of these two new innovations of war, the flintlock musket and the socket bayonet, that led to his incredible victories.
However, neither would have been possible if it weren't for the courage, skill, and ultimately sacrifice of those that wielded them.
In the end, the Battle of Blenheim created the British Army and introduced the world to a fighting force that would dominate warfare for over a century, the British Redcoat.
Company, attention! Audience! Dismissed!